Some people are more exciting than some other people. But it's all according to who you are, who creates excitement. Some create excitement in some kinds of people, some create excitement in other kinds of people. So everybody's exciting to somebody. And Simon Peter seems to be exciting to some of us. And I would like for us to continue to get acquainted with this very remarkable person of history, Simon Peter. Today's lesson is called Simon Peter, the First Preacher and the First Sermon. And open your Bibles to the second chapter of the Acts of the Apostles. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. There appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, Behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? How hear we every man in our own tongue, wherein we were born, Parthians? This is over where the nation of Iran is today. And Medes, the Median Empire, came from the same area. The Elamites, and that is the same area. I just wanted you to know that the first three that are named come out of that Near East, where there's so much turmoil as of this moment. Dwellers of Mesopotamia, same area. And in Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, other parts of Libya, Cyrene, strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians. And we do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God. And they were all amazed and were in doubt, saying one to another, What meaneth this? Others, mocking, said, These men are full of new wine. And verse 14 says, But Peter. You could have expected that, couldn't you? But Peter. He rose in defense of the blessing that had been promised prophetically. He rose up in defense of what God was doing at that very hour. He refused to keep his mouth shut when people were mocking the experience that he had just received from heaven. And he rose and gave the first talk, the first lecture that was ever given after the church was born, because it was born in the same hour. This was the first hour and the first sermon of the first hour. If you were to analyze the talk that he gave, it has 22 points and in his sermon. And becoming the first preacher, the first sermon on the first day, the first hour of the first church in Jerusalem, made him quite an important person in history, because anybody who studies the church are compelled to go back to the first. And when you go back to the first, you will go back to Simon Peter. It's exciting to me that the main thing that Peter involved those people in was the thing that they did not want to hear, and that was the resurrection. And so in verse 22, that same chapter, says, Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. He did not blame it on the Jews or the Romans. And when you do today, you're out of line with Peter. It says, Ye have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain by the determinate will of God, whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of death. So here we hear Peter, as he put to his listeners brought them into a receptive mood. He says, You men of Israel, hear these words. That was, a nice beginning for him. And maybe that's the way to begin a talk when you're going to talk to people that you know don't like you. is to say something nice to them. He said, ye men of Israel. He let them know that they were people of Israel. They just told you they came from all over the world. They were there worshiping. They were religious people. And he said, ye men of Israel, hear these words. And then he described Jesus, number one, as a person approved of God. And the proof of Israel being approved of God were the miracles, the wonders, and the signs that he said all of you know about. Not done in a corner, but all of you know about them. Then he told about his mission on the earth to save the world and his death by divine appointment, and that he was not a victim of circumstances. It wasn't something he had. He wasn't a martyr. He gave his life to save this world. His life was not taken from him. On the cross, he gave up the ghost, the Bible says. And so how glad we are that he willingly gave himself. Then he began to vindicate the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, and that the pain of death had to loose him and to let him come forth. And so in his first sermon, he became involved in the resurrection. I don't believe that today as many people involve themselves in the teaching of the resurrection as the New Testament teaches. The focal point of Christianity is the resurrection. That Christianity could be another religion were it not for the resurrection. That the resurrection is the focal point of Christianity. He was dead and he is alive, and we know it, you see. And so we should never forget that. He made this strong through bringing in prophecy. Every one of these Jews would believe in the prophet Jeremiah, would believe in the prophet Isaiah, would believe in the prophet Moses, would believe in the prophet David. And so they were a people acquainted with prophecy. And so in Acts 2:25, he immediately begins to work in the area of the known before he gets into the area of the unknown. They say that that is the way to deal with people in a lecture, that you begin with a known quality, that they know something. And so you refer first to their known qualities. And then you move from there into that which they don't know. And there's where you begin to teach them. In Acts 2:25, for David speaketh concerning him. Now this was a prophecy, of course, because David lived 700 years or more before. And so David speaking concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is on my right hand that I should not be moved. Prophetically speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 26, therefore did my heart rejoice and my tongue was glad. Moreover, also my flesh shall rest in hope. Verse 27, because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell or the grave, neither will thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. What a prophecy. What a tremendous prophecy that David gave. Verse 28, thou hast made known to me the ways of life. My, isn't that great? Thou shalt make me full of joy with thy countenance. That's what Christianity is all about. David, the greatest Israeli that they had, spoke directly of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look in 2 Samuel chapter 23 and verse 1 for a moment. These are David's last words. Now these be the last words of David. David the son of Jesse said, and the man who raised up on high, the anointed of the God of Jacob, and the sweet psalmist of Israel said, I want you to be sure and identify him, you see. The Spirit of the Lord spake to me, and his word was in my tongue. You see? And so he began to speak from a man that they trusted, that they believed in, and in order that they might know that the phenomena that was taking place before their eyes and ears, that phenomena was one that was of a prophetic nature coming out of the mouth of the one that they loved the best, you see. The one, David, that was possibly their greatest king that they had ever had. Also, Psalm 22 describes the Christ's execution and him giving himself. And so it is a further prophecy that came out of David for the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we read these verses that were given on the day of Pentecost, it makes us know that if that's the kind of sermon that should be preached, it is a sermon of life, of resurrection, and of power. There were many things he could have said, but he didn't. He brought them straight to the core of Christianity, which is the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then Acts chapter 2 and verse 32, he says these words, And this Jesus hath God raised up, wherewith we all are witnesses. Now here were the infallible proofs, the infallible evidence that the Lord Jesus Christ had risen from the dead. What is so remarkable to me, that in the first sermon that was ever preached, that the main teaching of that great sermon was the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that those people, some of them that were seeing him there, that they had seen him too, and they saw him in his natural life, and they were acquainted with him. And he said, now he is not dead. He is raised up from the dead. His body was not stolen, as some liars tried to tell, but he is alive, and he's at the right hand of God now. And so his message was so remarkably rooted deep into the truth of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 33, the next verse says, therefore, being at the right hand of God exalted, you could call that a bitter pill, I suppose. Being at the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, now he's connecting, now he has moved from that which they knew unto that which they need to learn. You see, now he's moved into what they have right here. Therefore, being at the right hand of God exalted, having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed forth this, which ye now see and hear. Now, I would say that that's great preaching, you know. That's not average preaching. That is great preaching. He just reached out there. He opened his sermon up by saying, these men are not drunk as ye suppose, seeing it's only 9 o'clock in the morning, and this stuff you drink around Jerusalem couldn't make anybody drunk by 9 o'clock. That stopped them dead in their tracks, you know, right there. But he said, but this is that. And then he used one of the prophets, Joel, by the prophet Joel. And Joel was a celebrated prophet, but he moved greater. And he said, but now David said, you couldn't get a higher authority into their hearts than this David. And then he came down and said, now listen, I just want you to know this has been witnessed by all of us. Not some of us, all of us. Whereof we are all witnesses. The supernatural manifestation of the resurrection was not a hidden thing, not select people, a few people saying, well, I've seen it, and I'll tell you about it. That wouldn't have worked. He had to be seen of anybody and everybody, all kinds of people, to have that infallible evidence that anybody would have to believe on the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you say amen? You say, well, what happened with such a tremendous sermon and so powerfully given, mostly regarding the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ? Verse 37, if you move down just a verse or two, it says, and when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Now, that is one of the remarkable verses of the Bible. Number one, it shows you what preaching will do. And I don't really like to say this, but the phenomenon of speaking in tongues got everybody confused. And the preaching got the confusion out. Are you here? Are you really here? Well, let me say it again. They all got happy, they all rejoiced, they all spoke in tongues, and had a whole mass of people confused. Peter got up and in their own language preached to them and taught them, and it says they were pricked in their heart. It's still the Word of God that pricks people in their hearts. It's still God's Word that pricks people in their hearts. And when the Word of God is ever relegated behind the scenes and something minor, you're going to miss God 100%. Whatever else you may do in church, the Word of God is the most important thing you can do. It's that which pricks in the heart. It's what turns men around. It's what make men believe. And otherwise, you may carry on a lot of different activity, and they might say, well, I don't understand you. You're just a strange bunch, and walk out. But when you get through preaching the Word with strength and power and anointing, then something happens. They were pricked in their heart. And they said to Peter, and they couldn't all get close to him, and it says, and to the rest of the apostles. They could get to 11 easier than they could one. And listen to what they said. They said, men. And then they said, brethren. Hey, that was a soft spot, wasn't it? They called them brethren. They had received them into fellowship. Men and brethren. Now, I don't know whether that brethren in this instant here is a Jewish word for everyone that's a Jew, that we're brothers, you know, by blood, or whether it was a spiritual brother we're talking about. But that may not be too relevant. Brethren speaks of relationship that's mighty close. And so whether it was a Jewish blood they were calling on brethren for, or a spiritual relationship that we belong to God together, whichever it was, it showed that they were sympathetic. They were pricked in their heart, and they had a tenderness of saying, we're together. When you got a brother, you're together. Can you say amen? Whether a spiritual brother or a natural brother. All right. Now, Peter responded. Now, he was some more preacher. He didn't even eat jelly, much less part of jelly. His backbone wasn't jelly. His backbone was steel. When it came time to tell you something, he let you have it full barrel. Peter said unto them. Now, you see, they said to the rest of the apostles, but they didn't have a chance. That Peter was always a ready man. Then Peter said unto them, repent. Put a little circle there. You know that was a hard thing. Don't you know who these people were? Every one of these people were pilgrims that had come up to Jerusalem to worship. They were the most religious people in the world. These were the most religious people in the world. They were all visiting the temple in Jerusalem to worship, the whole bunch of them. That's what it says here. It says that they were come up to Jerusalem to worship from all these nations. And so the first thing he said was, repent. Now that gets people when they come to a service like ours. They come out of some type of fundamental church, and we say, well, get saved. Well, I belong to the church. Well, I didn't say belong to the church. Get saved. Sometimes the truth is hard, isn't it? You know, to take it and to accept it. He didn't say, honey, I'm so glad you accepted it. Now let's have a right hand of fellowship. No. They didn't offer me a right hand of fellowship there. No. You know, we got a thing in this country that's going that's very weak, and we should never be a part of it. Saying now, would you make your decision for Christ? We don't really want you making decisions. We want you to get born again. And decisions won't do anything. A decision is a thing of your soul, which is your mind. It's not a strong part of you. And it's not a decision you need. You need to be born again and a new man move inside and a new nature move inside and a new power move inside and a new person move inside, and you are a different person ever after that. Did you know that if you have black eyes, your wife has black eyes, and you have a baby, very likely they'll have black eyes. And if you got blue eyes, your wife's got blue eyes, you have a baby, they'll likely have blue eyes. Are you still here? All right. Did you know you go get a person saved and they're very likely be something like you because you led them to the Lord? And if you're a weak person, you're more likely to bring a weak person into Christ. I used to get so disturbed years ago in the denomination I belonged to. The way they open up churches, they send out Bible school students to open up churches. Well, I said, if you want the weakest mess on the face of the earth, get somebody to do it that don't know how, and you'll really have it. No wonder your churches die. They were born half dead. Send out your apostles and your prophets to open up your churches. Send out your mighty men to open up the churches. Get them born. Get them born with strength. Get them born with the right kind of spirit in them. Get them born dynamically. Yeah. And then they'll be great. Weakness never produces greatness. To have greatness, you have to have greatness. And so Peter said to these people, all religious people, get right with God. Repent. And he looked at him a little closer and said, and you need to be baptized too. Now we've already had 4 drops of water. Nah, we're going to submerge you. You say, why would he want to do that? Baptism is an emblem of death to the old life. When you read Romans chapter 6, when you are buried with Christ in baptism, you shall rise with him in resurrection. And so when we go into waters of baptism, we're going to Calvary, where Christ was buried, and we are being buried like he was buried. And when we come up out of the water, that's our resurrection. And then we walk the resurrected life. We don't walk the old life anymore. You see? We walk the new life. We're born again. We're resurrected. We've come up out of the watery grave. He said, be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. The one they hated and the one they'd killed, you know. Get baptized in his name now. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, if you want to make a note there in your Bible, all salvation has always been by 3, from Genesis to Revelation. In delivering the people of Israel, they had to have the blood on the doorpost to keep the death angel out. They had to have the Red Sea opened in order to get through. And they had to have the cloud of glory to guide them to the promised land. So they had the blood, the water, and the spirit. They had 3. And when you went into the temple in olden days, when you walked in the door, the first thing you found was the altar of blood. And then the lava of water, where if the priest did not wash, he died. And then you had the Shekinah glory behind the curtain. And so there you had the blood, the water, and the spirit. And so in the first church here, they repented, which is the blood. They were baptized, which is the water. And he said, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And these 3 are your salvation. Your salvation is not 1. Your salvation is not 2. Your salvation is 3. You're fully saved when you've got 3. Everybody still here? We'll have water baptism service real soon. The salvation is 3. It is the blood, the water, and the spirit. For the promise, and verse 39 is maybe the key verse to the whole of what Peter said. The promise is unto you. It is to your children. It is to all, say all. That's you. All that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. The call of God is a call of repentance. As long as God is saving people, he's also filling them with the power of the Holy Ghost. Verse 40, and with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. 3,000 souls found the Lord that day when Jesus pierced their conscience, pierced their prejudice, and caused them to come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as their wonderful and glorious Savior. And then you have the eternal promise that God will not change it. God will, from that time until this time, that he will give you the same blessing that he gave them. If you're glad for it, say amen. How would you like to belong to a church that one day had 120 and the next morning it had 3,000? Huh? Yeah. Isn't that something? Isn't that something? What we want to do is to stay with the original. We want to be like the first church. We don't want to be like the church over here or the church over there. We want to be like the original church. And the original church is the book of the Acts of the Apostles, from chapter 1 right through 28. And so if you wish to be one of the original Christians, you'll go to the Acts of the Apostles and ask God to help our lives to conform to that book. And that first sermon is a good starter. If you can live up to the first sermon, you can take the rest of the book. And that was preached by this very unusual person called Simon Peter that we have studied about for so many Sundays now. And we still have two or three other Sundays to go before we are finished teaching you about this very remarkable person, Simon Peter. When Christ first found him, he seemed to be so near nothing that how he could ever be something would be great. And God took him from that and made him one of the great men of the ages. And God still is making great men today. And God wants to bless you, strengthen you, to raise you up, to use you. So let's fall in line and let God do everything that he wants to do in all of our lives. And all the people said, amen. Let it be. We want to thank you, Lord, for this person, Simon Peter. We want to thank you that not only was he there when the Lord said, I'll build my church on what you've just said, and the gates of hell cannot prevail against it. But on the day that the church was born, he became the spokesman of the church of Jesus Christ. What a beautiful thing. And he evidently gave the message that the world needs to know, the resurrection of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that he is beside the Father in heaven at this moment, is our intercessor. Until we see him face to face, keep us faithful. Until we see him face to face, let us be blessed. Now for your blessings upon all those who hear and all of those that see, bless them. And we thank you for it. And all the people said, amen.